In the middle of the night, I go walking in my sleep. From the mountains of faith to a river so deep, I must be looking for something, something sacred I lost. But the river is wide, and it's too hard to cross. It's a song about a quest to find something sacred, something meaningful in this world. And I think it's a quest that all of us can understand to a certain extent. I mean, from the beginning of human consciousness, ever since human beings recognized that they were in this universe, they've been looking for their place, trying to understand who they are, where they fit in, and what gives meaning to life. And that's what this song is about, that universal human quest. But there is something different. There is something rather new in this song. Because as Billy Joel sings of this quest for spiritual meaning, he talks about traveling and walking away from the mountains of faith and towards a river that is so deep. And what does that mean? The mountains of faith, as I understand it, I think they represent the main spiritual religious institutions of our society. Religions like Christianity and Judaism and Islam and Hinduism are these mountains that have long towered over the spiritual landscape of this world, that have told people how to pursue their spiritual quest. But in this song, Billy Joel, he's traveling away from the mountains of faith. He is engaging in this quest, but not within the mountains of faith, not within the institutions of religion. And the journey, as he describes it, it passes through some interesting terrain. It is a journey through the valley of fear, through the jungle of doubt, and through the desert of truth. He's not looking for the answers to these spiritual questions in the places where people traditionally look for them, but rather in the dark and hard places of life. And the goal is the river. And the river, it might be deep and it might be wide. It might be a little bit scary, but that is the place to which the singer is always going, the river. So what then does the river represent? Traditionally in Western society, of course, the idea of a river and crossing the river represents death. That's usually what it symbolizes in our literature. But Billy Joel is not speaking about death as he sings this song. In fact, he denies it. He says, I'm not sure about a life after this. God knows I've never been a spiritual man. So it's not about what happens to him after he dies. It's not about spirituality as traditionally understood. The river, we discover, as the song ends, is in fact a baptism. Baptized by fire, I wade into the river that runs in the promise of land. So the river is a baptism, but not a baptism as we would recognize it in the Christian church. It's a baptism by fire, for one thing, not water. And since he has said he's not a spiritual man and that he's moving away from the mountains of faith, it's a different kind of baptism. So what exactly is Billy Joel describing in this song? It's a spiritual quest. But what kind? I think, in fact, that this song is a reflection of an emerging sense of spirituality that we see in our society today. Because people today in Western society, they are looking sometimes desperately for answers to important spiritual questions. But what we are seeing is this: they are not looking for those spiritual answers in the places where people have traditionally looked for them. And in particular, they are not looking for those answers in institutional religion. In fact, many people seem to have concluded that the very last place they will find meaningful spiritual answers is in institutional religion. And we see this happening all over the place. And it's not really that people are rejecting belief. People are still believing in God. They are still believing in things like angels and heaven, and they are still believing in all kinds of things about Jesus. And in fact, people today seem to be all too willing to add to their systems of belief, and so people are embracing new beliefs, or at least beliefs that are new to Western culture. And so people will profess to believe in karma, and reincarnation, and feng shui, and a whole host of things. Belief, as such, is not really in decline. But what is declining rather rapidly, rather shockingly, is faith in religious institutions. And this is something in our society that is affecting all established religious institutions right across the board. But what we see is that because Protestant Christianity is the largest religion that is not being replenished by immigration in Canadian society, it is feeling this trend most strongly. So this is an absolute trend going on in our society. People looking for spiritual answers and yet not looking within established religion. It doesn't have any. It is not organized. In fact, the whole point of it is to resist any sort of organization, and yet it is a sociological trend. And so people have been looking for a name, a label of this phenomenon. And so the name that is often given to it is taken from the description that such people will often give of themselves. They will call themselves spiritual, but not religious. So that's how people will tend to refer to this movement, and it is a movement within our society. In fact, lately I've even started to hear it as an acronym. People are referring to SBNR. SBNR people. It's become that common. I think we could definitely say that this SBNR trend is a threat to the church, as we have known it. I mean, of all movements, of all religious groups, of all faith groups, or philosophies, or even atheism, this is the one that could take the church down. Not out of open, overt hostility, of course, but more out of a sense of apathy. And so many Christian churches are beginning to react to this SBNR trend and see it as a threat. And so in many churches, you will hear people rail against it and criticize it and mock it, because they recognize it as a real and genuine threat. But should we react like that? First of all, I think we need to recognize that this trend, this tendency in our society, didn't come out of nowhere. It is, in fact, a very legitimate critique in some ways of religious institutions and what they have been. I mean, the fact of the matter is that religious institutions, including the church, have often failed, have often stood on the wrong side when it came to issues of hatred or racism or whatever it might be. People are tired of Christian churches condemning certain groups, gays, other minorities. People are reacting against that. And on top of that, of course, Christian churches have often failed. They have failed to take care of people. They have sometimes hurt people, mistreated people, even abused people. Churches have failed. So it's not out of nowhere that people have come and said, you know what, I want to pursue my spiritual growth and spiritual truth without following in the prescribed path of some religion. This didn't come out of nowhere. But you know what? It's not just the people who've given up on institutional religion who see this. I mean, we who continue to be part of the life of the church, we are as much, if not more, aware of the faults and the failings of the church. But we're still here. Not because we think the church is perfect, not because we've got it all right, but because the issue is not whether or not it's hard to be the church together it is. The issue is whether or not it's worthwhile. And it is. And we're here because we know about it. What would Jesus think? What would Jesus think of what's going on in our society about people abandoning, turning away from religious institutions and trying to seek spiritual answers apart from them? What would Jesus' reaction be? Jesus often didn't have good things to say about religion. Not the religion that it was practiced in his day. He was a sharp critic. On one particular occasion, his opinion came out quite clearly. He was passing through the region of Samaria, and he got caught up in a discussion with a Samaritan woman, a person who lived there. And this woman tried to drag Jesus into a religious discussion and religious argument. So she turned to Jesus and said this, "Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you say that the place where people must worship is in Jerusalem." She is referring to an age-old religious argument between Samaritans like her and Judeans, or Jews, like Jesus. See, both Samaritans and Jews believed that the right way to worship God was in the temple. And so they each built a temple. The Samaritans built their temple on Mount Gerizim. The Jews, the Judeans, built their temple on Mount Zion in Jerusalem. And they both insisted that their place was the right place and the only place to worship God. So she's trying to pull Jesus into this old argument about who's right and who's wrong. The classic religious argument. And you know what Jesus could have done at that point? He could have beat her at that game. He could have told her off. He had the traditions of his people to appeal to. Yes, they believed that Jerusalem was the only place. Not only that, but Jesus had the Bible that he could have appealed to. There are all kinds of passages in the Bible that insist that the only right place to worship God is at the temple in Jerusalem. He could have taken up those Bible verses and hit her over the head with them. That's the traditional thing that religious people do, you understand. They take their scriptures and beat up on each other. But Jesus doesn't play that game. He doesn't play, "We're right and you're wrong." He resists that. And that alone should tell you that Jesus is somewhat ambivalent about religious practice and religious tradition. But then he goes on to make it quite clear, and he says this, "The hour is coming, and now it is, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father seeks such as these to worship him." Do you understand what Jesus is saying here? True and proper worship of God doesn't need a religious building, doesn't need some sacred space, does not need any sort of religious infrastructure or tradition or institution. All it needs is spirit. All it needs is truth. So Jesus wasn't all that committed to religious institution. Nor was the early church that followed in his wake. I mean, look at Stephen in the book of Acts, an early leader of the church. He was dragged before the authorities in Jerusalem, where they accused him of actively working to destroy the temple, to destroy the traditions of the people of the Jews. And Stephen gave a lengthy response to those accusations and never really denied them. Jesus and the church he inspired were kind of ambivalent when it came to religious institutions. And yet, despite that, within a few centuries of the departure of Jesus from this world, the church became the most successful, most powerful, best organized religious institution in the history of the world. So successful at it that in many ways the very success of the church is today working against it as people feel they need to reject the power and prestige that the religious institution of Christianity has built up. So I don't know what Jesus would think. As Jesus would look around at people today, would he recognize more closely those who are committed to the institution of the church, or would he recognize those who count themselves as spiritual but not really religious? Sometimes I wonder. I don't wonder for too long. I do think that Jesus does believe in the church. Not necessarily a religious institution, but that Jesus does believe in the church and has a goal and plan for his church in the world. The big problem I have with people being spiritual but not religion isn't necessarily the way that they reject religious institution or the things that have gone wrong with religion. I understand that. My big problem is that they are seeking and setting out to work out their faith, to work out their relationship with God, all on their own. And that's a problem. Because we weren't made to do it on our own. We were made to do it together with our sisters and brothers. And no, you don't necessarily need a big infrastructure or a big institution to do that, but you do need one another. Christian faith was meant to transform the world, not just to make you feel better about yourself. And to transform the world, we need one another. God is committed. God is committed to this thing that Jesus called the kingdom of God, something he wanted to build and establish in this world. God is not committed, as far as I'm concerned, God is not committed to various human, institutional, religious forms and institutions. As far as I'm concerned, the Presbyterian Church in Canada, its structures, its traditions that it's built up over the years could pass away, might pass away. I would be sad, of course. But that wouldn't necessarily change my faith that God has something for me to do in this world, and more important, that God has something for us to do together as a congregation. However we make that work, working together to establish God's kingdom in this world, that's what it's about. And so we do find ourselves today on a journey. And yes, it may well be a journey away from the mountains of faith, from the religious institutions as we have known them. And we may pass through the jungle of doubt and the valley of truth and the desert of fear. But we're not alone on the journey. And God will lead us on through the river and on to the promised land, for he has promised to be with us. And on that we can rely. Let's take a few moments in silence.